Joining us is
as always.
As always, I'm out of it. It's, you know, I should have taken the weekend off, and I don't. I don't stop. I never stop. I just keep going and going until I crash. Joining us is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America Pack. He also writes the Down with Tyranny blog, Howie Klein. Howie Klein, the Blue America Pack raises money for progressive candidates all around the country. The DCCC will not run anybody against Speaker of the House Paul Ryan, but I understand the Blue America Pack has found a candidate to take on Paul Ryan.
Yes, we're part of a coalition of groups that have been scouring the southeast part of Wisconsin, which is where Paul Ryan has his district, and we've been doing this really, really hard. I mean, certainly Blue America has been nonstop working on this, and we finally found someone who would be a great candidate. Not us alone, but Working Families Party, which is strong in Wisconsin, and the labor unions, who are, you know, very, very strong, and in fact much stronger than the Democratic Party in Wisconsin. So between the labor unions, the Working Families Party, and Blue America, we have come up with an incredible guy named Randy Bryce. Mm. And he hasn't declared yet. It's still sort of under the radar a little bit. People don't know yet, although in the next few weeks, I think everyone will know. Your listeners are getting a little early warning on this, something that hasn't happened yet, but will.
He's an iron worker?
Yes, he's an iron worker. He is, he's the real thing. I mean, Hillary lost that district. This guy is pretty much the opposite of her. I mean, he's got all the good stuff that she had, like, you know, he's pro-choice and pro-equality and, you know, all that sort of stuff, and he's good on the environment, as she was. But when it comes to the bread and butter issues that people didn't like her stance on, the kind of, you know, a little bit establishment way that she approached that stuff is very different from Randy, who, it was a leader of Bernie's campaign in his part of Wisconsin. And in fact, Bernie won that district in the primary. It's very much when people describe the white working class districts that she did so poorly in and that Trump won, this is one of those districts. I mean, Obama won the district and Hillary lost the district. And the DCCC has never, ever once run a candidate there. Not only do they not run candidates, but when candidates do run there, they sabotage them. And when I talk about sabotaging a candidate, people say, well, what the hell is he talking about? And what I'm talking about is Steny Hoyer and Ben Ray Lujan and Nancy Pelosi getting on the phone and calling unions and calling big Democratic donors and saying, don't give, you're wasting your money, don't do it. This time, they're not going to be able to do that. Randy is very beloved among the unions. He's an activist in his union, and he's the head of the AFL-CIO's outreach to veterans. He's a veteran as well, but he's the head of their veteran operation for the whole state. And in his part of Wisconsin, he's an official of the Iron Workers Union. So he's not someone that the Democrats are going to be able to mess with the way they have messed with previous candidates. So that's a really good thing.
I'm going to challenge you.
Before you do, I just want to just put in a little plug here.
Okay.
Which is that Randy, you can follow Randy at Twitter, on Twitter by his name, which is Iron Stash. So in other words, he's an iron worker, as you mentioned, and he's got this big mustache. So he calls himself Iron Stash on Twitter. What's the challenge?
I'm going to challenge you, just to make it interesting. You say yes. That they don't run anybody good against Paul Ryan.
They don't run candidates against Paul Ryan.
Okay, so Ryan, I'm looking this up. Paul Ryan, the Democrats ran a guy named Ryan Solon.
He ran as a Democrat. That's different from the Democrats ran. I mean, the DCCC doesn't run any candidates against him. And what I said is that not only do they not run candidates, but they sabotage anyone who looks like they could possibly give a Paul Ryan any kind of a challenge. So this guy, Ryan Solon, was just some random person who ran, and the DCCC didn't even look twice at it. It didn't matter to them. He didn't raise any money and he didn't make any noise and it just didn't make any difference. But the last time a viable Democrat ran against him was a few years ago, and a guy who had been a local city official in I think either Racine or Kenosha, one of those towns, a guy named Rob Zurban ran against Ryan, and he managed to raise a huge amount of money, and the DCCC freaked out. And they really were, you know, flipping out that he could actually, you know, cause Ryan some kind of damage. And they really went after him in a horrible way. So instead of helping a Democrat, a good, solid, progressive Democrat who was raising lots of money and looked like he could do some, you know, maybe win, possibly win, mm-hmm. You know, they didn't want to know about it. Now, I want to tell you why this is so horrible. I mean, it destroys the Democratic Party when the DCCC does this kind of stuff. For just as an example, this coming in 2018, the U.S. Senator, who's a Democrat, a very good progressive Democrat named Tammy Baldwin, is up for re-election. Don't you think that if there's a Democrat running in one of the congressional districts, it's going to help to turn out votes that'll help Tammy Baldwin keep her seat? That's expected to be a very tight and crucial race. I mean, the Democrats need everything they can get to keep her in the Senate. It's crucial. It's so important. And yet here we have the DCCC just say no. That's it. That's all they know how to do when it comes to Wisconsin. They published their list of districts that they're going to be targeting this year. I mean, some of the districts that they're claiming they're going to target are absurd. I mean, literally absurd. A district in Alabama where they have as much chance of electing somebody in that district as you have of becoming Trump's vice president in the next month. I mean, it's insane. And yet they have no candidates in against Ryan, but no candidates in the state of Wisconsin at all. They're not targeting one district in Wisconsin, a purple state, where Democrats win. And that's the DCCC for you. I've said so much about them already. I feel like your audience is probably ready to kill me. And when I say DCCC, by the way, that's Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee. They're charged with electing Democrats to the House, and they do a terrible job at it.
I want to pitch you an idea for Down with Tyranny that you might want to write or assign.
Oh, I hope you want to write it.
Here's the idea.
Okay.
Paul Ryan is going to kill 24 million Americans with his new health care plan. He's from Wisconsin. Do you know that Wisconsin is notorious for producing serial killers? Supposedly, there's something in the water that drives people mad. Jeffrey Dahmer, Ed Gein, David Spanbauer, some guy named Walter Ellis. They're some of the greatest serial killers in American history.
Did you know that I wasn't a serial killer, but someone went into a Sikh temple in Ryan's district and shot a bunch of people there, and that was just a couple of years ago while Ryan was in Congress.
He follows in a long tradition of serial killers from Wisconsin. I'm being serious. Wisconsin is plagued by serial killers.
I would love you to write that story for Down with Tyranny. I think you would make it really funny and fun.
All right, hang on. I'll do it if you'll edit it for me, because I tend to overwrite.
I'll edit it.
All right, I will write that. Okay, that would be fun. North Carolina has been disciplined by the Supreme Court. North Carolina used to be a Democratic stronghold. The Republicans have taken it over, and they want to keep all their power by making it impossible for African Americans to vote. Twice the Supreme Court has wrapped their knuckles saying, stop it, this is racist. And the North Carolina legislature goes back and they rewrite their gerrymandering laws and their voting right laws. You say something is happening in Illinois on Memorial Day yesterday. What happened?
Yesterday it happened in Illinois. It's a little bit different. I mean, what the Supreme Court did was fabulous. And what hopefully that, and what it's based on the idea of racial gerrymandering, that you're not allowed to use race to egregiously gerrymander a state. So they tore up their map. They said these two districts are cannot be used and you have to redraw them. The thing is you can't just redraw two districts because the districts around them are then affected. So they really have to come up with a new map. So that's really good news. The other part of that, though, that's important, is that what the Supreme Court has, the conservatives on the Supreme Court have always said, is that partisan gerrymandering rather than racial gerrymandering is okay. And the Supreme Court seems to be moving away from that now. So there'll be some cases that come up probably pretty soon. There's one, in fact, in Wisconsin, the state we were just talking about, where they say, well, we didn't do racial gerrymandering. We just did partisan gerrymandering. So they purposely try to pack Democrats into a few districts so that there would be lots and lots of Democrats in just a couple of districts, and that would make it easier for Republicans to win in districts where there were fewer Democrats. So now the Supreme Court is considering that and a few other cases, and that's imminent. So that's an outgrowth of this Supreme Court decision that came down a couple of weeks ago in North Carolina. Now, what happened yesterday, which has to do with voter participation, is that the Illinois legislature met. I was surprised to hear that they were meeting on Memorial Day, but happy that the House met. So what had happened is I think about a week or so before, the Illinois State Senate unanimously, so that means every Republican and every Democrat, voted unanimously. So yesterday, the Illinois state legislature passed also unanimously a bill for automatic voter registration. That means if you go and get do any kind of business with the state, like get a driver's license, renew a driver's license, anything that has to do with the state, that automatically registers you to vote if you're a citizen of the state. So if you're a citizen of legal age, and you get a driver's license, that means unless you ask not to, so you could opt out if you don't want to register to vote, but unless you ask not to, that means you can register to vote. You are automatically registered to vote. So that's a really good thing. It passed in Illinois yesterday. Like I said, the week before, it passed in the Senate unanimously. Yesterday, it passed in the House unanimously. Now, it had passed the year before as well, but they've got a Republican governor, this guy Rauner, who's pretty awful, and he vetoed it. But they worked with him to address his concerns, and now it looks like he's going to sign this bill that passed yesterday. Now, today, Maine is looking at the same bill. And just before I spoke with you, I was on the phone with Shanna Bellows, an old friend of mine who's a state senator in Maine and an ultra-progressive. She's fantastic. She used to be the head of the ACLU in Maine, and she ran for the U.S. Senate, but she's in the state Senate now, and she's the sponsor of this automatic voter registration. So the Maine House passed it on Thursday. So last Thursday, the House of Representatives of Maine passed this bill. Every Democrat, every Independent, and one Republican voted for it, so it passed. It was narrow, but it did pass. And then today, the state Senate is going to vote on it. They need to get one Republican to go along with it, and then it'll pass. The problem with it is they have a terrible governor, this crazy guy named Paul LePage, and he's very likely to veto it.
Right. He's the one who's trying to get rid of all the socialist art in the state capitol.
That's right.
And he's a racist.
He's against increasing the franchise. He's against more people voting. He really opposes that stuff, and he will veto this bill.
He's going to veto the bill. How do you know he's going to veto the bill?
Well, as soon as he got elected and a Republican legislature was in power back in 2010, they did a very odd thing. In the early 1970s, I think 1972, Maine was one of the first states to do same-day registration. So same-day registration means when you go to vote, you can say, hey, I want to register to vote that day at the same place. So you can register to vote and vote on the same day. So that's considered really, really progressive. Maine has had that for over 40 years. Along comes Paul LePage. And what does he do? He has the Republican legislature repeal that, of something that's been on the books for over 40 years. This is a crazy person. So fortunately, Maine has this thing that other states don't have called the people's veto. And Shanna, by the way, was the the head of a basically a state referendum to repeal the repeal, and they were successful. So Maine is still a state that has same-day voter registration, thanks to Shenna, who, as I said, is the sponsor in the Senate today of automatic voter registration.
Explain to me what automatic voter registration means. It means same-day registration, or you're just automatically registered?
Yeah, if you deal with the state in any way, like I said, a driver's license, say, for example, that automatically, if you're a citizen of the state, and you are whatever age the voting age is, I guess it's 18 everywhere. I think I'm not sure. I think some states may have a different voting age. That's what I've read a little bit about. There's some questions about that, but I think there are states that have slightly different voting ages. I think it's 17 and 18 though. Yeah, not for federal elections. So for federal elections, it's 18 everywhere, but in some states, for state elections, it's 17.
Right.
In any case, so if you're of the right age to vote and you deal with in any state office, like the DMV is a good example, you will be asked if you want to opt out. If you want to opt out and not register to vote, then they don't register to vote. But other than that, you will be registered to vote. So Oregon did this, and they were the first state. They did it in 2015, and it's gigantically increased their voter participation. And then the second state that did it also in 2015, but a few months later, was California. So it's really starting to happen all over the country. I mean, Connecticut has it, Colorado has it now, Alaska passed it, Vermont. There are more and more states that are doing it. New Jersey passed it also, but again, unfortunately, they have that huge slob, I can't remember his name. Oh, Chris Christie, he vetoed it as well.
He also vetoed a bill that would have outlawed underage marriages. You read Nicholas.
Strange guy.
Yeah, you read that.
I bet he would also outlaw a bill that outlaws marrying your cousin.
Uh-huh. I'm going to ask...
Oh, no, that was Giuliani. I keep mixing them up.
Right. If people were allowed to vote in this country, if the people who are willing to get off their ass and go vote, were allowed to vote, if all the people who wanted to vote were allowed to vote, what would this country look like?
Well, it would be far more progressive. There would be far fewer Republicans in office. So how do I know that? There was a study recently done about what happened in Wisconsin. Why did Wisconsin go, you know, very, very narrowly, but it did go for Trump. And how did that happen after giving such good, solid majorities both times for Obama? And what they had instituted some very, very stringent anti-voter legislation in Wisconsin. They have a state Senate controlled by the Republicans, a state House controlled by the Republicans, and of course a very, very right-wing crackpot Republican governor. And they have really strict voter ID, which very specifically targets black people. And the elderly and students.
The vulnerable.
So they do what they can to discourage people from voting instead of encouraging people from voting. And when you think about Wisconsin is the birthplace of progressivism. I mean, it's the last state in the world you would expect to be doing this kind of thing, but they did do it. And it and African American voter participation in 2016 was way down. And it is thought, certainly this study that I looked at makes the assertion that is the reason why Trump won. Fewer voters. That's what they aimed for, and that's what they got.
Going back to gerrymandering, do we know if in 2016 whether or not more Americans voted for a Democratic congressman than a Republican congressman?
No.
There have
been times when the Republicans have controlled the House, even though there were as many as a million fewer Republican voters. Mm-hmm. But 2016 wasn't one of those
really?
Times.
Really?
Yeah.
That kind of speaks to Trump and gives him a bit more of a mandate than I was willing to give him.
Wait, what does it have to do with Trump? You were talking about congressional people voting for Congress.
I know, but, you know, he didn't win the popular vote, but the fact that the Republican House got more votes than the Democratic House gives them a little bit more legitimacy. No?
Well, okay. I mean, it shouldn't. You shouldn't have that in your mind because most Republicans, not all, but most Republicans, certainly most Republican incumbents, did much better than Trump. So in other words, you go to, you know, I'll just pick a district at random that I was thinking about recently, a district in Houston where John Culberson is the congressman. Culberson won re-election handily. He won, I don't know, 60%, say. He did very well. And Trump lost to Hillary in that same district in Texas. So Trump, even in the districts that a lot of districts that Trump won, he underperformed the Republican. He underperformed almost every Republican senator. So that's an easy comparison because it's a whole state. So, you know, Republicans, you know, John McCain. I'm going to make this figure up. This isn't a real figure, but just to give you an idea, John McCain got, I don't know, 3 million votes in Arizona, and Trump had 2.5 million votes in Arizona. So that those aren't real figures, but it gives you the idea of what I'm talking about. The senators, the Republican senators, almost all of them beat Trump.
Gianforte.
Forget that whole thing about legitimacy.
Okay. Donald Trump is an illegitimate president. The Republicans are illegitimate. Greg Gianforte is the new congressman from Montana, despite body slamming a reporter for The Guardian. Were most of the votes already cast when he...
Yes. 260,000 votes had already cast, so the majority of votes had been cast. The Secretary of State reported they were getting calls all day from people asking if they could change their vote. Unfortunately, the vote on election day was not that different from the early voting. So Gianforte was going to win this thing with or without the body slamming. I think that there were even some people, some Republicans, not people, who were excited about the body.
Yeah.
They thought it was a good idea. He raised $100,000 that day, and people specifically, some, not all of them, but some people specifically saying they were giving him money because of the body slamming, because these horrible, you know, liberal media types deserve to be beaten.
He actually identified the reporter as a liberal reporter.
Right. I don't know how he knew that, but somehow he thinks he does. I mean, I don't know what that reporter, I don't know that reporter's politics.
If you're a reporter and you're trying to ascertain the truth, that automatically makes you a liberal in America.
Well, maybe that's the point. Maybe that makes you a liberal, wanting to report the truth. Because what the guy was asking him, I mean, Gianforte, although he told a call full of lobbyists that he was overjoyed that Trump Care passed. He was trying to raise money from lobbyists, and they were on the phone when Trump Care passed, and he was overjoyed about it. But when it came to talking to the voters, he couldn't very well say, I'm in favor of this bill that's going to take away 10% of the people who live in Montana, take away their insurance. He didn't want to say that. So what he said is he can't make a comment on how he would vote on it until he sees the CBO report. So the CBO report came out, and what this reporter was asking him is, hey, the CBO report came out. Can you make that comment now about how you'll vote on the Republican health care bill? And that's when he decided to beat him up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it wasn't just body slam. According to the Fox News reporters who were there, who swore on an affidavit, he also choked him. They said he put both his hands around the guy's neck and was pummeling him.
Well, it reminds me of Grimm, the Congressman Grimm, who threatened to throw...
Grimm threatened to do that, but no one ever saw Grimm do that. Here we have witnesses. I mean, Grimm has done much worse than that. Before Grimm was a congressman, he was a murderer. But but and a mafia guy.
What?
But no one ever saw him murder anybody.
Really? I thought he was like an FBI agent or something.
He was a double agent. He worked for the FBI and for the mafia, and he would go back and forth, and eventually the mafia kicked him out because they realized that he was more on the mafia's side than on their side.
More on the FBI side than the mafia.
Oh, no, he was more on the mafia's side.
Oh, he was kicked out of the FBI for being more on the mafia's side.
Mafia still embrace him.
And he threatened to throw a reporter off the ledge inside the Capitol. He ended up going to prison for tax evasion, I believe, or campaign finance laws that he violated.
They let him off very, very, very easy. I mean, they had so much stuff on him that, you know, he resigned from Congress and was able to, you know, get a very light charges against him. He has a long record that goes way, way, way back, and the FBI is very, very savvy to it. But he, you know, always made a threat that he could bring down a lot of people with him. I'm sure he could have.
Right. Greg Gianforte is 56 years old. I'm going to assume this is not the first time he's been violent with somebody. Sending him to Washington, D.C. will be interesting.
Yes. I don't think that the other members of Congress are excited to have a violent guy like that amongst them. But, it's everything is so partisan these days that people don't look beyond party labels.
Everything is so partisan right now. Is it more violent now than you've ever seen? You have the governor of Texas holding up a pistol and saying he's going to use it on reporters. There's a lawsuit. One of the white supremacists who beat up a protester at a Trump rally is suing Trump because he says Trump claimed that if you punch a protester, I'll pay your legal bills. How violent is our culture? I mean, I was around in 68 when Robert Kennedy and Martin Luther King were assassinated. Is this as violent as 68, or is it just being overreported?
Well, I don't think it's being overreported, and we are yet to see how violent it gets. I mean, Trump has certainly created a very violent milieu, and I'm somewhat worried about it. I think a lot of people are worried about it.
Yeah,
he's enabled these kind of people to, you know, I mean, everyone saw what he did at his campaign rallies, telling people, you know, bemoaning the fact that you have to be politically correct and you can't just break their legs and stuff like that. You know, and his fans are, you know, there are a lot of them are, you know, extremely low IQ, and a lot of them are very, very addicted to prescription drugs. And you put that together and you have you could have some major violence.
And they have guns. They're addicted to guns and the adrenaline of being angry.
And Oxycontin.
Yeah. Before you go, I want to ask you about Tom Price's seat, but two questions. One is, you weren't expecting Gianforte to lose, were you?
I was hopeful. I was definitely hopeful that he would lose. I don't know that I would say I expected it. I knew it was going to be close. I had seen polls that showed him leading, and I had seen polls that had shown, what's his name, the singer leading.
Mm-hmm. And that would have been a major. I'm sorry?
Rob Quist, the guy who's the singer.
But that would have been
It would have been a big upset, yes. And most of the professional polling elite said that Quist was going to lose. They were all positive he'd lose, but I felt it was going to be close.
Tom Price gave up his seat to run Health and Human Services and destroy Obamacare. There's a special election coming up. Where does that stand right now? When is it, and what are you expecting to happen?
Well, the most recent poll shows the Democrat ahead by 7, John Ossoff, leading Karen Handel, the Republican, by 7 points. That's huge. Most people are saying, ignore that poll. It's an outlier. Because every other poll shows them 1 or 2 points, just 1 or 2 points separating them. So I tend to think that this is a tie. And again, it's going to all be about turnout. If the Democrats turn out their people, Oslo will win. If they don't, then Handel will win.
And when is that election?
Again,
when is it?
Just like in Montana, the amount of money that the Republicans have poured into this is mind-boggling. I mean, they're pouring in 6 or 7 times more than the Democrats are.
So, when is this election?
It's June. I forgot which day it is, but it's a couple of weeks from now.
It's coming up in June. And finally, Trump care. Is McConnell going to make it happen?
Well, he's going to try to make it happen, whether he can succeed or not. If he can succeed, it'll be a miracle, because there are so many Republicans that have said no to this issue or that issue that I don't see how it can. Mm-hmm. And then you had Trump, sort of still high from his perceived home run that he hit in Europe, although no one else sees it that way, but he does, coming back and saying, we need to pour more money into health care. Which I'm sure that all of the Republicans in Congress are thinking, what the hell is he talking about now? Because they're taking money out of health care. You've got people like Lisa Murkowski from Alaska and Susan Collins saying they're not going to vote for the bill if it includes defunding Planned Parenthood. Okay, well, the Republicans in the House are not going to vote for the bill unless there is the defunding of Planned Parenthood. So there's a lot of that on a lot of different levels. I mean, especially Republicans who are seen as vulnerable in some way are not going to vote to defund Medicaid to the tune of $880 billion. They don't want to do that.
Right.
That's going to put a lot of people, it's going to kill people. So my gut tells me that McConnell's not going to be able to pull this off.
Okay. And lastly, before you go, and this really is the final before you go, two things are happening right now. One is Kim Jong-un keeps firing these ballistic missiles into the Sea of Japan. Trump is silent, not saying anything. It's also pretty much settled that the only way to get Trump out is through impeachment, that Mueller's investigation will reveal obstruction of justice, but there's no way to prosecute a sitting president unless you get rid of him first. So the only way to get rid of Trump is political. You have to do it through impeachment, and you can't impeach the guy unless you overthrow the House of Representatives and then the Senate. So he's going to be there for a while.
Probably. I mean, the thing is, remember, if Mueller finds a smoking gun, a real smoking gun that even Republicans can't stomach, he could be impeached. I don't expect that he'll be impeached until 2018. If the Democrats take back the House, I think there's a good chance that Trump will be impeached. Now, being convicted is another story. Remember, Clinton was impeached, but he was not convicted. The Senate found him innocent. So that's a political vote, and it's not likely that the Democrats are going to have 60 votes. I mean, the Democrats are not going to have 60 votes to find him guilty. So yes, you're right. He will be around probably until 2020, unless he keels over eating some fast food or he decides to retire or resign for one reason or another. He'll be there till 2020.
The smoking gun may be North Korea. What happens when Mattis and Rex Tillerson and China say, okay, that's it, no more test missiles, rah, rah, we're going to war against North Korea? What happens to impeachment then?
Did you say China?
Yeah. Wouldn't China go in and discipline North Korea now? Isn't there talk that China is going to work with
That talk is from Trump. I don't think North Korea is China's going to do anything like that. But let's just leave China out of this and just say that the U.S. decides to do something. I don't know what it is that they can do. I mean, you don't think they're going to fight a ground war in Korea, do you?
I'm saying that once they find out that Trump obstructed justice and it's incontrovertible evidence to impeach, he starts bombing North Korea.
Well, he can't bomb. He's not bombing anybody. And I don't think that Mattis and Tillerson and any of them are going to go along with something that crazy. I really don't. I don't believe.
Mattis went along with the travel ban.
Yeah. Well, the travel ban is different from incinerating Seoul and Tokyo.
Okay. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. People should go to the Blue America PAC and give money to the Blue America PAC. If you're a progressive and you want to give to a cause where all the money goes to where they promise, then go to...
Well, actually, let me interrupt you there for a second. What we encourage people to do is to give directly to the candidates, not to the PAC. If they want to give to the PAC, they're welcome to. We love it. But we... Most of the money that comes to the through Blue America goes directly to the campaigns of the progressive candidates, and we would much prefer, since the candidates know best how to spend their own money, how to spend money, we prefer people to donate to them. So we have a list of progressive candidates that are well vetted, who are guaranteed progressive, and if you go to the Blue America PAC, the list is there, and if you want to give one guy $5 and one guy $10 and one guy $1. Or you only want to give $100 to one person and nothing to anybody else, you have all those opportunities to do that.
Right. And pay attention, because the only way to get rid of Trump is through politics. And read,
I think you're right.
Yeah. And read Down with Tyranny. I get to talk to you next week, sir.
Great. Look forward to it.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, David.